Hi, welcome to the If Not Now, When podcast series. Today, I'm talking to Osita Chidoka, a leader in the opposition People's Democratic Party, about Nigeria's governance structures. What do the terms restructuring or true federalism actually mean? What are the things we really do need to change about our current structure? And what part of this restructuring discourse is actually a distraction from the difficult realities of governance? Are we too obsessed with structure when we really should be focused on function? After all, no country structure is perfect. This is the first in a series of conversations I will have with leading Nigerian intellectuals and political leaders about Nigeria's governance structures and what we need to improve governance. I really enjoyed kicking it off with Osita, and I look forward to your feedback and any suggestions you might have about other guests to continue this conversation with. Enjoy.
Thank you very much, Amaka.
So recently, the political parties all chose their candidates for the 2023 elections. And one of the issues that should be prominent in this election cycle is one about governance and Nigeria's governance institutions. Now, one of the things that Nigerians talk about often when you ask them about governance is restructuring, right? And I've never quite understood what that term even means and what people mean when they use it. Can we just start by maybe you explaining what do you understand by the term restructuring, or what do you understand people to be referring to? What is it about?
Okay, so that's a very good question, and it has a very lengthy answer, but I will make it short. First is, there is a nostalgia in Nigeria with our First Republic politics, where we had powerful regions and a more or less a weaker central government. So many people are saying that Nigeria was developing better in the 60s with those regions. So they are saying, let's go back. The military came and then did the unification decree and then went ahead to bring about what I call a unitary command structure to governance. Mm. So the military controlled every aspect of our life. So from the federal government that owned only one university, the British handed over the University of Ibadan to the federal government because it was owned by the British at the time. University of Nigeria, Soka, University of Obafemi Awolowo University, Ife, University of Lagos, Amadibolo University, was all founded by the regional government. And in 1970, nearly after the war, the federal government acquired those universities. But then the federal government expanded into all spheres of Nigeria's life. So as we passed through the 70s with the oil boom, nobody complained because the federal government had enough resources to pay for it. By the 1980s, the tension came in when the oil prices slumped. And then President Buhari came the first time with austerity measures. And then we went into the structural adjustment era. So people are saying the reason why Nigeria has broken down is because we abandoned our 1960s model and chose a unitary model that didn't allow the states to have capacity and power. So we need to restructure Nigeria along the lines of regional government. So some propose that we move from the four regions to six regions. And interestingly, the idea of the six regions kind of stuck, six zones in Nigeria. Right. So we have the northeast, northwest, north central, southeast, southwest, south, south. That kind of stuck in everybody's head that we need to have larger units underpinning the federal system we have. I think that is the trust of what I hear most from people. But again, it is a very faulty premise.
Okay. Yeah. I was going to ask, so we'll come back to this idea of sort of whether the states really don't have capacity, right, to do different things. Because I think that's also a flawed premise personally. But I want to explore that. But first, I know that you have also called this idea of restructuring a fraud.
Yes.
Right? Tell me what you mean by that.
So my point is that where we are in Nigeria today, we have 36 states, we have legislature, we have a constitution that gave powers to the different arms of government, the different tiers of government.
Yeah.
Now, abdicating responsibility, having work avoidance, where people are not holding the government closest to them accountable for what the constitution has asked them to do, and focusing on a tomorrow of restructuring, for me, is the biggest fraud that is going on in Nigeria. It's just a scam. Because what it does is that it removes us from discussing today,
right,
and keep talking about the future, right, or the past. But my conversation is, I want to talk about today.
Right.
Okay, so my state doesn't have capacity, but my state receives 3 billion naira thereabout every month from federation account. So maybe 5 billion if you average it.
Mm-hmm.
So the state has about 70, 80 billion plus internal generated revenue. I want to ask the question, how does my state recruit its staff? How does my state public service work? How does my state determine how to spend capital and recurrent expenditure? How does things that are purely under the purview of my state, for instance, the issue of land management, certificate of occupancy, the issue of town planning, how are my states handling those issues? Because the big ticket issues that people talk about, we need state police, we need the states to have more functions. My question is, of course we can have state police, but that is on the premise that the states themselves are functional entities.
Okay.
So we have seen progressively the degeneration of Nigeria. And that degeneration, I agree with those asking for restructuring, is that the federal government has beaten far too more they can chew. I agree. The state creation weakened the state because suddenly you had a situation where somebody was an assistant director in the old Anambra Civil Service, and then they created Enugu out of the civil service. So he goes to Enugu and becomes a director. Then they created a Ebonyi state out of it. He goes to Ebonyi and becomes a permanent secretary.
Right.
So he hasn't quite gone through the mill from level 10 to 19. He moved fast to 18 because of state creation. Many people didn't understand how that damaged the Republic of Nigeria. Most of the functions of the state, as the state creation was happening, the human capital was being weakened. We didn't quite have enough human capacity,
right,
to manage those entities. But that's a problem we can fix. It's not a restructuring problem. It's a problem we can fix.
But even, and I want to, you know, make sure we're being fair, I guess, to the restructuring arguments, because I think what you've described about going back to the six regions is just one aspect of it, right? There's this fluid, nobody, you know, some people say it's about fiscal federalism, some people say it's about state police, some people say it's about, but like even this six regions, is it politically feasible? Can you see a world in which somehow all of the current 36 states agree to give up, you know, basically break themselves down and like morph into some central states, you know, at the regional level? Is it actually feasible?
So
in fact, it almost seems a little bit like more centralization, right? Because you're asking maybe six states to like become one state, feasible?
So there is the issue of capacity that comes with a certain level of centralization.
Yeah.
That is to say, the federal government doesn't become too powerful and the states too weak to engage the federal government. So that's a fair argument.
But is it feasible politically?
But the political feasibility is very weak.
Yeah.
I don't see anybody coming together, giving up their states, hard fought and one state to morph into a regional government. But the point is that regional government is born of a false premise. The 1960 to 1964, 65, wasn't an El Dorado in Nigeria. It was a problematic period in Nigeria.
Mm.
It was the period where we had state of emergency in the Western region, where the action group couldn't remove their premier because the federal government kind of intervened. It was the region when we had an election boycott in Nigeria, 1964. The whole of Eastern region and Lagos boycotted the federal elections.
Right.
There was no election in December 64. The next election in the East was in March 1965. And guess what? The first thing Tafawa Balewa promised when he became premier, when Zig, after 5 days of waiting, and Zeke now called him to form government, he promised a constitutional reform. The states have even, the federal government have even started the process of state creation. They created the Midwestern region. They were waiting to create the Cross River, Ogoja Rivers agitation. They were asking for states. The Middle Belt was asking for states. So there was already agitations in Nigeria.
Meaning you're saying it's not exactly going to be the panacea.
Yes, it was the panacea.
So back to your point about, let's focus on what we have today,
yes.
Right? So today, we do know that in the Constitution, local governments and states have responsibility over certain aspects of service delivery, healthcare, education, local roads, even some security, we'll get into that, tax collection, like all of this stuff. So why isn't there more focus? Like you were saying, your state gets a certain amount of money. Why aren't we focusing more on what are the states actually doing with the powers they currently have? Why is that not a part of the conversation?
Because ethnicity and politics of division has made it that all of us focus on the federal government. We're still living in the past. You see, the Nigerian state of 1970s was a very capable state. It was strong. It had the military in charge. It had bureaucrats trained by the colonial masters. So they had national development plans. They built the major highways in Nigeria, built a brand new port. The Tinkan Island was built in months. They built federal government colleges. They built new universities. They gave bursary awards to schools. Mm-hmm. So everybody's knowledge, the people older than me, their knowledge of the federal government of Nigeria is a very good memory.
Competent.
You could deliver services. So the civil service, that federal government is what people are hankering after. But embedded in that federal government was the seeds of his own failure, because as he acquired more and more roles, as he created more and more opportunity to intervene in all areas, he weakened his own capacity.
But is that...
He weakened his own capacity.
I feel like that's almost blaming, because look, you need a level of strength at the center for any federation to work, right? Like in a federal system, the central government sets guidelines, yes. Right? Leads on vision, leads on planning, and then states execute. So saying that to some extent that the central government filled a void that was lacking in terms of social delivery, to me still doesn't quite explain why the states aren't taking up some of these roles. And I know that in previous, so for example, one of the things that I've heard is the reason, and we've discussed this before, is that when the military was in charge, the military sent, you know, military governors, I don't know what we call them, administrators,
yes,
to the different states. They weren't from the states. Their job was to manage the states and manage the ethnic issues in the states and report back to Abuja, right? So one of the things, when I think about it, one of the things I think about is the years of military rule conditioned Nigerians, right? And the military government at the center encouraged, come back to Abuja because your boss is here in Abuja, not in the states, right? And we haven't quite gotten out of it since we got out of military rule.
That's one aspect of it.
Okay.
The major aspect is that the federal government didn't now have the resources for what they have taken on to do. In 1980s, the economy went south. Nigeria became a heavily indebted state. The London Paris Club was about 40 billion. Nigeria couldn't even service its debt. We couldn't even form a budget without the World Bank and the London Paris Club agreeing to our budget terms. We needed to clear with them every year to make our budget. So that state that was, you know, acquiring universities, even when a state has built a school, the federal government will go and turn it into a federal school. That hospitals, the federal government will go and build a new one. That state suddenly now didn't have money. So what he meant was that when the democratic rule came, the attempt by the federal government to continue to do what the military had done, Obasanjo was in nostalgia of his time as National Shipping Line, Nigeria Airways, and all of that. They found out that those had become drain pipes for the individuals who were appointed to those positions. Then the first major restructuring of Nigeria then happened under Babangida. Babangida realizing that the state did not have the money to to continue this charade, now decided to do privatization. That was the first time the federal government changed its tone. It moved away from banking, from insurance, from things that were of commercial nature. So they sold it to the private sector. And you see what has happened with them in the private sector.
So one aspect, so you're saying the federal government took on all these responsibilities and then couldn't sustain them because they didn't have money.
Yes.
But what about the responsibilities that were still left to the states? So that's kind of what I want to be devil's advocate and push on, right? So the states still have the responsibility of education, of health. The states still have own primary schools, certain primary schools, you know, primary healthcare centers, still supposed to be run by states. Why are we not talking about that level of social delivery and not, you know?
That all of us are living in the past when our federal government did all those things for us.
Yeah.
Both under the military and, you know, subsequent federal civilian government. We're all living in the past. We've refused to come back to the reality that that federal government doesn't exist no longer anymore in that form.
Yeah.
So that we need to focus at the local level. Now, let me tell you, all the taxes that we collect in Nigeria, the taxes the federal government collects are the central taxes, the company income tax, the custom duties, and they collect VAT on behalf of the states. Now, the critical tax everywhere in the world that funds government is the personal income tax.
Yes.
The states have no capacity to collect it.
And it's their responsibility.
They only collect the withholding, the ones that companies deducted at source. So if you notice, it is all the taxes that government pays that they collect back. You rarely will see them registering the people, putting a revenue organization, getting everybody to file their taxes at a particular point in the year, and then being accountable to the states on how they're spending their resources.
Right.
Rather, they want to collect revenues from markets, from people, so that there is no effort, the difficult job of collecting the personal income tax.
Yeah.
They're avoiding it. The difficult tax of collecting tenement rates and property taxes and focusing it on using for local healthcare, local primary schools,
local
roads.
Yeah.
Because they still want to be able to control the government without anybody disturbing them in the states. Once the tax payment of the state increases, there will be an inverse interest in the state. So now that they're spending Abuja's money, the tendency for everybody in Nigeria is to keep looking at Abuja as a salvation.
But I also see it's such an interesting, ironic status quo equilibrium, right? Because in a way, it's self-serving, right? For a lot of governors and for people at the state level to say, the federal government is not doing this. Look what the federal government is not doing. Look what the federal government is not doing. Because it takes attention away from what we are not doing at the state level, right? And at the same time, you are, you know, so... For example, when we talk about fiscal federalism, right, which is one of the things we said some people mean when they talk about restructuring. If you really wanted, you know, competence to collect taxes at the states, you start with the ones that you already have responsibility for, like you're saying, right? Personal income taxes.
Yes.
But actually, the people who are talking about fiscal federalism are actually talking about the federal government giving states more, right? It turns the argument on its head because you start off framing it as, oh, we want to decentralize power. But really what you're asking for is for the central government to give you more. So then you're actually centralizing conversation in some ways, right?
You missed the point in that argument.
Okay.
The argument is that the federally collected revenues, that the federal government is keeping an unfair amount of federally collected revenues. They're keeping 52%. So the states are saying, no, the functions of government are at the local levels. You shouldn't keep 52% in Abuja. That's why there is a mad rush to Abuja. The fiscal federalism people are saying, for the federally collected revenue, the revenues from royalties, from mining, from oil, from the federally collected taxes, in the past was a strong measure of derivation principle. The states, wherever it is collected from, gets more. And then there's a federally disposable pool. And the federal government got less.
Right.
But in 1971, the federal government turned it around and now started keeping more because, like I said, they took on more functions.
Right.
But the states are saying, don't keep that. Physical federalism is saying, it's because of this 2% that we are fighting in Abuja.
But the problem, I see that as it's a political argument. Like, to me, it's almost a cynical argument, because if I'm a voter, why should I trust you
yes.
with more money from the central government when you're not doing
this money is collected on behalf of the federation.
That's fair, but it's the point is yes. that the central government is collecting yes. the only people right now in our federation who are collecting significant monies in revenue is central government authorities.
Yes, because
right?
they're collecting the
because
easy
they're
taxes.
Collecting
the easy taxes.
But those are the ones they have the legal authority to collect, yes. unfortunately,
well,
right?
And
because they can't collect personal income taxes.
And primarily the military. Read our constitution. That's where the fiscal federalism people talk. That before now, the collection is from derivation. When the cocoa was being produced in the western region, when granite was being produced in the northern region, those regions got back the bulk of the money. Federal government collects it for them because of export duties and all right. of that. But when you finish, you return it back to the state, the palm oil to the southeast.
Right.
But now the federal government collects the revenues from the royalties, custom duties and everything, and is now keeping...
So, but my question is, if according to the current legal structure,
yes.
you have the authority to collect, what is, for most countries in the world, for most normal countries in the world, every normal, the primary bulk of revenue, personal income taxes.
Yes.
You have the legal authority to collect it.
Yes.
You have the legal authority to collect property taxes.
Yes.
Why should I trust you? And you come and you're arguing, actually, no, just let me collect. The one central government is already collected. Just let me collect it. I'll do a better job.
No,
right?
Not saying let me collect it.
Well, some people were. Like, no, Rivers was arguing that we should decentralize collection of VAT. Right?
Which is...
That's one of the arguments. But I'm just saying, why should I trust that you can do that when you haven't done the one... that you actually have the right to do.
So don't forget, and I'm now on the other side of the agreement, because don't forget that right. the VAT was an agreement by the states to say, we collect the sales taxes, and
right.
it's different, it's
right,
problematic,
right, right.
everybody's complaining, we pay in Enugu, then we pay in Lagos,
right.
we're the same company. And then the federal government, they came together, the states came together and said, let's collect a value-added tax. It was introduced by Babangida's government.
Right.
And then said, federal government will collect it on our behalf and give and take a certain percentage for its cost of collection and then return the VAT to us. Now, what the problem is really, I think the River State government hasn't quite framed the issue.
But I don't want us to get into this very political...
It's not the political part.
It's kind of a political argument.
Is, okay. mm-hmm. When you have collected that revenue...
Mm-hmm.
called value-added tax, then you shouldn't use the federal allocation principle in sharing it. You should give it back to the states where it is collected.
Okay, I don't...
So
yeah.
Now, no, what I'm saying is, mm-hmm. so they are now challenging the federal government, saying, it is not part of the law. You are not allowed to collect VAT. It's not in our law. Federal government is not allowed to collect VAT. It was by the agreement of the states. Our constitution is clear. So that's why the court ruled VAT is not a federally collected tax. It's not in the constitution.
Okay, but my question is, as a voter,
yes.
why should I trust the state?
No, you shouldn't trust.
To the collect... Because it almost sounds like a negotiating tactic to get a larger share of something the central government will still collect. Because if I really wanted to collect it,
yes.
start by showing that you can collect the ones that you already have the authority
so
to, right?
That argument is neither here nor there. My point is that the major issue is it is not a federal tax.
Okay.
It is not supposed to be collected by the federal government. It is by the agreement of the states that the federal government is collecting it.
That's
settled.
But, yeah.
And that's what
so
the courts have settled.
So one of the things that you have advocated for in the past, right? Like, how do we change the status quo of like bringing more focus on the states?
Yes.
One of the things you've said is maybe the federal government should just stop delivering some of these services.
Yes.
Right. I mean, maybe tell me about it. What do you think? How do we, other than people like me and you talking about it, how do we change the focus from the things the federal government is not doing, which is a lot, right?
Yes.
That's fair. They're not doing this. There's competence problems, capacity problems, yes. But there's also competence problems, capacity problems at the local level,
yes.
closer to Nigerians, critical services that they should be delivering. How do we change the conversation?
So, like I said, the part of our constitution that allowed for concurrent duties gave the federal government leeway to operate in every part of the economy, which is fine. But I think the federal government should restrain itself into a regulatory body, into certain standards, into forcing. They've done it in banking. The federal government used to own all the banks in Nigeria. They no longer own it. And the banks are working very well. The CBN is regulating them. They used to own all the insurance companies in Nigeria. The insurance industry has grown tenfold since the federal government left it. So I'm saying, why are we afraid of stepping back and saying, these are the new standards. This is what I expect you to do. Because the federal government's direct intervention is weakening its capacity. It's stretching it across too many areas. Since the federal government stopped appointing MDs and boards for you, for banks and insurance and public companies, do you see people still lobbying for those things? No. The banks are appointing. Nobody's asking the ethnicity of any bank MD. What people are asking, the vice chancellor of this university must come from our state. Because the federal government, when they built this university, the man from the other state was VC. I said, what's the problem? Give it to them.
So the big risk, I hear you. So you're saying federal government, retrace your steps, get out of doing some of these things you're doing.
Yes.
Create a void.
They won't create a void.
So that's the risk. So that's my, so let me push back. Let me play devil's, advocate for a second. A lot of our political discourse in Nigeria focuses on complaining about what the federal government isn't doing well or isn't doing. Even though we complain that the federal government is doing too much, there's an irony there, right? If you then say we shut down the federal schools.
Yes.
That's where most...
We hand over to another set of people. We can hand over to the private
sector. Okay, let's say we hand over to the states.
We can hand over to greater trustees of the federal government and just set new standards.
So the risk...
And give students scholarships, give bursary awards, make interventions when you need to. So if the federal government needs to intervene, like in the US, you know, you apply for FAFSA, the federal government gives you loans to go to college. Why is why are they hiring teachers? Nobody's hiring any teacher in the United States. No federal government owns any university.
So the risk...
To own them.
So the risk is that the standards of those federally delivered services also fall.
Yes.
And that's the problem I have.
It has failed. It's totally failed. No Nigerian...
But the states are not doing better. So if, say, for example, we said...
Afebabola University is doing better. Imo State University, Abia State University was one of the top schools in Nigeria at some point. There are many state schools that are doing better than the federal government. The federal government is just not capable of running those institutions.
Yeah, but the problem... So I hear what you're saying. But there's no reason why...
The government college is collapsed.
So you're saying, get the federal government out of providing some of these services.
Yes, and focus on standards.
But there's already...
Focus on interventions.
But there's already private sector delivering some of these services. So why can't it be simultaneous?
Why?
Because some of the people can't afford to go to private schools,
Nigeria,
for example.
Only 2% of JAMB applicants apply to private universities. Only about 2.something% apply to private universities. They can't. And the problem with the federal universities
is because they can't afford it.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is free. And somebody has to pay for education. There's no way you can get the
shelter. What about the people who can afford it?
The federal government should intervene with loans, with grants. The federal government can say to universities, that's fine. I want you to take this every year. I have money available. So we will pay the school fees for these students. That's... creates an agency issue that you are now making sure that you are getting value for your money.
Okay. So what would that solve, do you think? So now give up the federal schools. Okay. What does that solve fundamentally about federal hospitals? What does that solve about our governance?
Take that part of the budget and give it to the people you've given the schools to, give it to the states. Reduce the clamor for Abuja. Reduce the clamor. This clamor of Abuja will continue so long as this bureaucracy keeps growing and has a lot of money to spend. Look around Abuja. All the public servants own the big buildings here. We know that. Look around Abuja. Look at every public...
Would that really reduce the clamor for Abuja?
It will reduce. Not just that. I'm saying a sequence of withdrawal from the concurrent list. Before now, in the regions, the best and the brightest were in the regions. That's why people keep talking about those regional days. Nobody, people that went to Abuja were the few, the states who sent to Abuja. The bulk of the civil servants were in the regions because that was where the activity was. That the activity returns to the states.
But the risk is that it actually increases the carbon for Abuja, because now everybody will be saying, oh my God, this thing they did has failed drastically. Now the federal schools are bad, you know, because however, maybe they gave it to people who are not managing it. There'll be issues, right? So now we're not getting this. And then now it's like, oh my God.
When we started telecoms, there were issues. But today, is anybody complaining about telecoms? Nobody's complaining. When we started the banks, we handed over UBA, Union Bank, there were issues.
Okay.
The costs were higher, this, that. But today, nobody's complaining.
So is there another way? So that's fair. So that's one way. Federal government withdraw. I'm skeptical that wouldn't come with a lot of political problems, right?
Yes.
Is there another way to do it the other way around? Like, to ginger the states?
Yes.
To take on some of these roles and put pressure on them to fill the voids that they're not, you know, collect personal income taxes. Maybe it's a deal, maybe it's make a deal with the federal government to collect personal income taxes and remit to you, because so far there'll be many states that just don't have the capacity to do it, right? So you have to start somewhere. Do you think that's politically feasible? Is there a way that the central government can force this instead of doing less? Because I mean, Our federal government does very little, in my view.
I've been a federal.
But can I? I mean, I know what you mean. But in terms of social services, Nigerians provide their own electricity, sometimes build their own roads, provide their own water. I mean, what exactly? Provide their own security. I mean, our federal government is not doing that much.
It's not the job of the federal government.
One solution that we've discussed to sort of getting more competence at the state level or more focus at state level delivery of services is for the federal government to retreat a bit and provide incentives, right? That's your suggestion. Mm-hmm. I worry that that's doing the same thing that we're complaining about, which is, again, waiting for the federal government to do something or not do something, right? Or again, looking at what the federal government is doing or not doing. Can we just forget about the federal government for a second, right? Which is, I mean, like I said, I don't even think the federal government does that much. I think that the little that it does is inefficient, and that's fair. But is there another way to ginger the states to move and deliver without focusing on what the federal government is or isn't doing?
Okay, let's put it this way. The quality of the manpower at the states and the conversations at the states are very low. The people like me and you are not in the state capitals.
Right.
The middle class, the people working for UBA, GTB, Mobile, Chevron are not in the state capitals.
Right.
The people working for international organizations are not in the state capitals. The people that are managing the federal institutions, all the parastatals, are not in the state capitals. So what you see is that the people that are left behind at the states are not in any way exposed enough or have the capacity to engage. One of the reasons why the states don't collect personal income tax so much is that if you look around, how many people in most states earn about $250,000 a month, $300,000? Go and look around that number. Who earns $400,000 a month, except federal civil servants who are working in CBN or in any of the agencies that are in the state, federal road safety, police, army, and all that. So my point is that without the state having sufficient bandwidth to keep construction companies to be based out of Enugu, because you see, I like the US example so much. There are people who don't do anything except working for a county. Contractors who are multi-million dollar businesses that only work for the county. So I have a feeling that if we can get the states, if we can, and it's a push and pull, to attract back that kind of manpower that will be pushing the states. Because that manpower is not there. They're in Lagos, they're in Abuja, sometimes we find them in Kaduna and Enugu. But that manpower is not there. Most states are rural. So there's nobody going to push the state governments to do A or B.
So one of the ways to do that is to create more autonomy at the local government level.
They have all the autonomy they require.
No, I mean in terms of financially. So one of the reasons why states are, I mean, governors are like emperors, yes, in Nigeria, because they control all the funding for the states and the local governments, right? And so everybody in the states is like a stooge for the government. The legislature is not independent. The local government is not independent. Everybody's waiting for the state to give them money.
There's no civil society.
There's
no civil society.
So one step would be passing the pending constitutional amendments, right? That create some fiscal autonomy at the local government, which would then maybe incentivize people, smart young people who have their own money, to run for those states because they know that they'll actually have control of the funding. So, but the problem is that the states will block that maybe. See, will they?
For me, I don't even think the federal... I've always had a very odd feeling that there can't be three federating units in a country. The federal government getting involved in how states, creating local governments federally and putting them in our constitution.
No, I'm not talking about that.
An aberration. And even discussing about how the local government... You see, my point is, every state has its own unique issues. Some states run the county system in America. Some states don't. Some states have more. Some states have less. It's just their choice. The issue of chartered cities, if I were to really make my radical view, I think we should remove the federal government from the local government from the constitution and allow the states to go and decide.
But you just said...
I'm coming in because the autonomy I'm looking for is the states. The bandwidth I'm looking for is for the states. Because you see...
Then how are you going to get that level of quality and competence at the states you're talking
because
about?
If, for instance, in Anambra State, we have 7 local governments instead of 21.
But let's not say, I want us to talk about what we have, because it's not going to change.
I'm asking a question.
Okay.
What does Onitsha South and Onitsha North mean? Nobody has responsibility for anything. Because Onitsha is one town. The sewers are not asking you which one is the boundary of South and North. The drainages are not asking you the boundaries of the local government. So the person creating it from Abuja didn't know that Obosi and Onitsha are just neighboring towns. So when you create these artificial boundaries and you come to the state, then there's a problem. The local government chairman in the South is not thinking about the drainage, but the water is coming from the North.
Aside from that example,
but I don't want to go into that.
Yeah.
Let's take what we have.
Yeah.
What we have today is that I think that state governments are the federating units in Nigeria. I want a situation where we start having these constitutional conversations at state level, where the states will meet and the state leaders should meet and say, this is how we want to run our state. For instance, why should the constitution stipulate 2 terms for every state in Nigeria? Why can't we determine that in our own state we want to have 1-term governors?
Yeah, maybe in the long term. But like, how do we even get there? I'm actually very fascinated by your idea of saying take away LGs.
Yes.
Because you are complaining about centralization at the federal level. We're talking about a federalization, but you want centralization at the state level.
Yes,
that's
because,
kind of what that's what. Which sounds inconsistent.
We have gone to 36 states, as we have gone to 36 states, we have atomized. There's a problem.
I mean, some of our states are huge.
No, there's a problem with decentralization. It's not always the solution to every problem. There is something called scale. That's why Google, Twitter, everybody's looking for that 1 million, that unicorn's value. Because that's when you begin to attract quality manpower. That's when you begin to attract certain types of people to come work for you.
That's fine.
Because if you don't have scale, you're going to remain a small company.
But you can do both, though, right?
So I'm saying that the decision for local governance should be taken at the state level. I'm not saying scrap them. I'm saying that this drip down from Abuja trying to force a local system on a state, it should rather be a state driven. The people of the state should determine the type of local governance they want. And I, for one,
think that
where we are today is that the atomization, the way we have broken down the states, is creating a problem of attraction of capacity, capable hands. I don't see Most states can't even sustain medical doctors, consultants, because the salary of a consultant in the federal government is almost four times what a state can pay. So there is a...
So what's the solution?
There's a problem.
To that then?
I don't have any solutions, but there is a problem that as we atomize more and more, we also lose the values of scale.
Yeah, and I think the solution to that, personally, I think the solution to that is what the Constitution provided for, which is you can get scale. So local governments are responsible for primary health care. Like the small, you know, you have a headache, you'll be having a baby. And then like states are responsible for a bit more complicated healthcare, and then the federal government. And that's how you get scale, right? So you can get, you know, you get better service at the local level for simpler things. And then as things get more complicated, This is all talk in theory.
Well,
it's not theoretical. That's what we have.
When we come to practice, I mean, people haven't run it. Yeah. I have run a system, and I can tell you what it means for the Federal Road Safety to maintain offices in local government areas. I know what it means. I know that the police stations in all the localities in Nigeria don't have money for electricity. They don't have budget for fuel. They don't have budget for anything.
But it doesn't mean you get rid of them.
No, I'm saying that being able to build that scale, that capacity for people to manage complex systems, even that managing local, look at the local private, the medical center in my village, you know, because it's not functioning. Because you see, people underestimate what it requires for somebody to track the number of beds we have, the number of people that go to the hospitals, the type of doctors that we're visiting, schedule the doctors to come on the days they're supposed to come, make sure that the people are paid when they're supposed to pay. Those are not jobs that you leave for anybody. They think that running a local center means just opening one.
Right.
Now they've opened it, and they now realize that all the vaccines that were brought couldn't be kept at the local centers because there are no refrigerators. People are becoming clear and clear that complex logistics are required. Primary schools, for instance.
But that's why we need more competence at the local level,
but you can't
not to centralize.
No, you can't attract competence when there is no money.
And that's why we need fiscal autonomy at the local level so that they actually have the control of their money.
The whole budget
and
for
then
the state is 200 million. Employ 1,000 people, and you see what that
but
does.
But if the state collected personal income taxes, then they'll have more money.
No, if the state collects personal income taxes. No, hold on. The state can only make money from personal income taxes when the population is prosperous.
The next problem.
When the population is
prosperous. No, but even if we collect what we have
Lagos,
now.
That's why Lagos is thriving.
Yeah.
Because all the key players are in Lagos. So you can collect personal income tax at levels that, you know, are sizable.
Right.
So I'm saying that in practice, all these talks are nice, but we need to go down to people who have knowledge of how these systems work and begin to tinker with them.
Right.
I'm not saying that some of my solutions are going to be applied today or tomorrow, but I'm saying deep thought is required.
Indeed. And on that note, since we are running out of time, let's put a pin in it here. For me, the big takeaway from this conversation is that we need to focus more on the function of government rather than its structure. We need to focus on ensuring that government at all levels deliver essential public services with the structures that currently exist, even as we continue to have conversations about how to improve those structures. Osita, thank you so much for kicking off this topic with me. I've really enjoyed this conversation, and I look forward to continuing it.
Thank you for being a part of today's interesting program. You can learn more about the NESG's If Not Now When campaign at www.ifnotnowwhen.ng. You can also listen to other interesting conversations by visiting www.nesggroup.org/podcasts.